Hi, this is Peter Asher, and you are watching Rabbi Doug.
We're going to see Rabbi Doug. We're going to see Rabbi Doug. We're going to see Rabbi Doug on your TV tonight.
But Daddy, I want to watch Monday Night Football.
Forget about Monday Night Football. There's no other thing we're going to watch on Monday but Rabbi Doug.
Yeah, Rabbi Doug on TV tonight. We're going to see Rabbi Doug. Oh, everybody talk about that.
Solomon, welcome to Taped with Rabbi Doug. We are here at the Fest For Beatles Fans 18, and I am here with Mark Lapidos, proprietor of the Fest For Beatles Fans. Mark, as we every year do this, tell me what number festival is this and what number in Chicago?
Number 42 in Chicago and number 130.
130 festivals.
Over 44 years.
And 130 festivals, 44 years of Beatle music. What do you attribute that hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people come back every year?
Thousands
of people come back every year to not only attend the festival, but to be immersed in Beatles.
Well, I'll quote you John's quote that he sent to us in 79. He said, tell the fans the music was the thing. It still comes down to the music.
Greatest music ever created. It is.
Greatest songwriter.
You certainly put together the best Beatles band in the world. Liverpool is unbelievable. We miss Chris, but here you have Joe, who's great.
Yep.
And it's a fill-in this week. Tell me, in the big picture of festivals coming up in the future, do you think you'll have some people you never had on before?
Well, look, we have Geoff Emerik.
Geoff Emerik is
new. Jack Douglas is going to be.
Jack Douglas.
Little Nicola.
Yeah.
That is true. We had the old people in New Jersey.
And now
they're playing again.
It is. And both of them told me that they absolutely love it. They absolutely love it very much.
Oh, okay.
You know who else told me he loved it? Roy Orbison Jr. told me that he wouldn't have come to Chicago if he didn't have such a good time in New Jersey.
He had a wonderful time.
Well, listen, I want to wish you much success. Thanks again for being on the show. Good. Stay with us. A lot of music, a lot of people to talk to here at the Fest for Beatles Fans 18. Peace and love.
This is Peter and Jeremy at the Fest for Beatles Fans.
Summer days again and dream of you.
we are. We're on Taped with Rabbi Doug. I'm here with the infamous Peter Asher, Jeremy Clyde. They are now together as Peter and Jeremy performing. First of all, I want to start out talking to you, Peter, because I listen to your radio show all the time, which you didn't have when I had you on the show last night.
That is correct.
And I've learned so much about you and about your career, about your sister, about everything. How has this radio show made a difference in your life? Because I know you enjoy doing it.
I enjoy doing it, and a lot of people seem to listen, so that makes it fun. So I get to meet a lot of the listeners. I try to answer everyone's emails, which takes a bit of time. But I have fun doing it. It's an obligation. You know, we've been out on the road for a while. I'm already panicking. They're about to run out of shows. I've got to get home. I have to write them. I have to record them.
Sure.
But like all work, it's hard, but it's nice. Satisfying.
So, Jeremy, what's it like? Both of you lost your partners, and here you are performing together. How exciting is this for you now to be on the road again and to have someone like Peter as your new partner?
Well, Peter's a very old friend. I mean, a really old friend. We were in 1963. We've been trying to work out. In fact, we gave Peter and Gordon a job. Even back in the day, how about that?
They got a record deal before we did.
Yeah, we were signed.
They took over one of their gigs.
That's right. So it's really fun, partly because he's a great old friend of mine, and also because, as Peter likes to say, we've got twice the hits and twice the stories.
That's great. Yeah. Well, I want to thank you both for being here at Beatlefest once again here 2018, and thank you for being with us, Peter Asher, Jeremy Clyde, right here on Tape with Rabbi Doug. We'll be back.
Thank you. Well, without love, 2, 3, 4.
Lock me away and don't allow the day here inside where I hide with my loneliness. I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love. Birds sing out of tune and rain clouds hide the moon. I'm
Taped with Rabbi Doug. We're here at Beatlefest 18, and I'm here with Jeffrey Allen Ross. He is the producer right now and a musician for Peter Asher and Peter and Jeremy currently. And he is a former member of Badfinger, and we know we've had other members of Badfinger on the show many times. And it's just a pleasure to have you on the show. You know, I want to tell you, last night when you went up on stage and played with the Liverpool band and stuff and everything, you seemed to know all the music, how to play it. You stayed up there through guest musicians and everything like that. Is that because you rehearsed with everyone, everything, or is it because you really knew all that music in the past?
I really knew all that music. There was a couple songs I didn't know, but I have this knob on my guitar that makes it go quiet. so if I didn't know something, I'd just pretend like I did. Mm-hmm. That was only just a couple of things, but for the most part, I know all the songs.
So you're a music producer and a former band member of a major band. What do you do besides Peter Asher here along the years musically? Because you are a talented guy, you have a great voice. You're not headlining here, but you could be headlining. You kind of filled in something because certain people are no longer here at the fest, taking up the space on stage and singing stuff, and you kind of filled all that in this year. How did it come about, and where did you get to be with Peter?
Well, let's see, where do I start? Well, let's start with the Beatlefest. The first time I was at a fest was in 1987 with Badfinger in New Jersey. So that was 31 years ago, and then it took a little hiatus, and then we started doing it when Peter and Gordon reunited. We did a few. So we've been doing that. I've been Peter's musical director for 12 years, since Peter and Gordon reunited. Uh-huh. I put together a band, and so I've been doing that with him, and I also, I engineer and co-produce his radio show on Sirius XM.
Which I talked to him about on the air. I sent him, when I had him on the show 3 years ago, I think it was about 3 years ago he was here, and I said, I knew who he was, I knew who his sister was, but I didn't really know things about him. But now that I listened to his radio show on the radio, I know everything about him. I know everything about him, just like he talks about on stage. You know, he does a lot of talking, telling personal stories. He does it on the radio all the time. Absolutely. So today, in my interview with him, I was actually so much more knowledgeable about his life and able to talk to him about it.
Exactly. So yeah, that was a huge moment, meeting him and getting to work with him, because I was always a fan. I mean, I was a Peter and Gordon fan when I was a kid, and then I met him, and the opportunity to work with him was, I have to do this. Uh-huh. And I've been with him ever since, and he's kind enough to, have me do session work for him and just be involved in a lot of his projects. So I do that. I also happened to play, we've just started doing a new show with Al Jardine from the Beach Boys.
It's great. Were you here in Chicago with Al Jardine? Were you at the City Winery?
At City Winery a few months ago.
Very nice.
And that's an acoustic show, sort of the same thing, where it's Al and his son Matt, mm-hmm. who is one of the great singers. Matt sings all the Brian Wilson and Carl Wilson falsetto stuff, and he's unbelievable. So I've been doing that, and that's been a real joy.
We're big fans of Jardine.
Apparently. Yeah. So that's like a whole new thing for me. And so I kind of do whatever. I just did a show with Billy J. Kramer. Uh-huh. I've known Billy for a long time. So I play with all the people that I like as people that are good people, and I like their songs, and
it's great.
I'll do if somebody pays me enough, I might do it. But I have to like them.
I understand. Let me go backwards to high school. Where'd you grow up?
I grew up in Madison, Wisconsin.
Madison, Wisconsin.
Which is where I'm headed tomorrow.
Okay. Did you have a bar mitzvah in Madison, Wisconsin?
I did indeed.
Oh, very nice.
1966, April 29th.
Very cool. Very cool. So let me ask you this. Did you have a high school band? Did you have a band together in high school?
Absolutely.
And you were playing in your own band,
absolutely.
Stuff like this?
Absolutely.
So what was your stepping stone into being a professional from being just a band member in your own band?
Well, once, once the Beatles happened, mm-hmm. it just became, that's what I want to do. Because, and I'm not making this up, when I was 12 and 13, my original goal was to become a rabbi.
Oh, wow. That's a great story.
Yeah. So, from one wannabe rabbi to a real rabbi, you know, that didn't quite happen, but I decided to get into music.
This is great.
And, you know, I've been playing professional gigs since I was 16, I think, something like that.
This is great. I can't thank you enough. Geoffrey L. Ross, amazing producer, amazing musician, here on Taped with Rabbi Doug. Much success with Peter Asher and his music. Much success with Al Jardine and his music, and your continued growing in your career.
Well, thank you very much.
I hope we will stay in touch and see each other again.
Yeah, you know, at 65 years old, you know, my career is just starting to happen, so I'm feeling pretty good about it.
It's pretty good. All right, Geoffrey Allen Ross, stay with us here on Tape with Rabbi Doug at Beatlefest 18 in Chicago. We'll be back.
Who am I? No, I'm Geoff Emerik, right? Recording engineer of the Beatles, right? And you're watching Rabbi Doug.
My name is Geoff Allen Ross. I am not Geoff Emerik. Yes, I got what I deserve. Can't you wait in there too long, my love?
Taped with Rabbi Doug at Beatlefest 18, and I am here with Geoff Emerik. Welcome to the show.
Oh, hi there.
Geoff is the engineer for Beatle albums from Revolver through Abbey Road. Tell me, Geoff, just right off, how the heck
do you end up being a Beatles engineer in the recording studio? Who were you working with before them that you ended up with them? Because already by the time they were Revolver, they were very popular, very well known, famous, had hit songs, hit albums. You know, how do you kind of get yourself in there in the middle of their career?
No, I mean, it's a long story. I mean, you've got 2 hours?
No, not 2 hours, just briefly.
Well, no, I mean, no. I started in EMI Studios when I was like 16 years old, like 15 years old. One thing led to another, I went up the ladder pretty fast. Norman Smith, who was the original Beatles engineer, right, left to become a producer. I was a young kid, and I think behind the scenes, the Beatles wanted to use someone who's a bit younger, not a 40-year-old man, for instance, right? Uh-huh. So anyway, I'm now promoted to be a replacement for Norman Smith at the age of 16, or 19 years old, right? So the first record I made was Pretty Flamingo by Manfred Mann. Uh-huh. So I was taking over Norman Smith's artists. Anyway, one day, and I used to work as an assistant engineer on a lot of George Martin sessions, right, with different artists. So one day I'm called up to the manager's office, right? And then the manager said, George Martin's got something to say to you, because George was up there. He said, do you want to record the Beatles? And I was a recording engineer for 5 months up to that point. And my heart sank, obviously. You know, Jesus fucking Christ, man, you know? So anyway, so I was playing a little mind game in my head with the bouncy ball, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no. And it kept going on to no, 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 no. And then I thought, well, I've got nothing to lose here, right? And it went on, yes. So I said, yes.
Mr. Emerik around?
So I said, yes, right? And then 2 weeks later, we started to record Revolver.
Wonderful.
Yes, I mean, and the first track I started to record with them was Tomorrow Never Knows, you know? Mm-hmm. And one, you know, the rest is history. I mean, it's a long, long fucking story.
So tell me about these guys, these four guys who are in there, who are let's say, touchy with each other and with their music. Did they accept you right away? Were they happy with your first takes of the things that you were engineering?
No. Well, absolutely, because, you know, I've been assistant engineer on some, which was operating the tape machines, on a lot of their singles, like She Loves You, uh-huh, and all the rest. So I was a familiar face, uh-huh, so I knew them. The problem, well, wasn't a problem, when we started to do Tomorrow Never Knows, which was the first track on Revolver, they wanted a different drum sound, a different vocal sound, a different bass sound, a different this, a different that. So there's no plugins in those days, right? So I had to try and go nuts and try and, I basically overload all the equipment I could find to try and create new sounds on the drums, the bass, the vocal. John's vocal for Tomorrow Never Knows is going through a revolving speaker. I mean, and luckily that day I sort of won them over. That's it in a nutshell.
That's
great.
So I know when you, just jumping ahead, you know, the last Beatles album that you worked with was Abbey Road,
right.
And I do know that you had said that Abbey Road, you didn't know it was going to be their last album.
No.
And so on. What was the difference on working with the Beatles in the studio at the time of a Revolver and at a time of an Abbey Road when they were ready to go their separate ways, but at the same time wanted to put together a tremendous album of songs that they had already recorded and new songs that they were recording?
Well, I mean, the problem was, I mean, I've seen so many ups and downs with them, right? And it all manifested itself on the White Album, which was a nasty experience for me. I mean, because I walked out like a third of the way through the album because it wasn't very conducive to have a nice vibe in the studio. So when it came to the Abbey Road situation, it wasn't quite as nice as what it used to be. I don't know, I've gone off a tangent, I forgot what your question was. But
the difference between working with them at Revolver time and at Abbey Road time? The difference with them and
it was almost similar, uh-huh, but the camaraderie wasn't quite there, right, you know? But at least now Harrison's a prolific guitarist, mm-hmm, and not a guy striving to be a guitarist, per se, because he wasn't a Lennon or a McCartney at that time.
Right.
You know? And, you know, that was his struggle through those years to become who he became.
Yeah.
You know, which was a really nice story. If you read my book, you know, uh-huh, you see this underlying story of George's struggle to become who he was. Look, if you read the book, you'll figure that one out.
Very good, very good. So tell me now, as you walk away with this legacy, here you are at Beatlefest, and hundreds of people have been lining up to meet you today, to get your book, to have you get your signature. But what do you think walking away with this legacy means to you? And do you have children?
No, I don't.
You don't? So what do you think it means to you and to future generations of people who worked with them throughout the years?
Well, I mean, I know what it means because it's a hard one for me because, I mean, it's so moving sometimes. Since I wrote my book, which is going back like 9 years, right, and we came to one of these Beatlefests in New Jersey, and I realized, we got engaged when we heard this song and got married and so forth. So coming here again today, which is like another, 8 years after that experience, it's even more intense from these people because I realize that their whole lives are completely based on what we created.
That's right.
Right? And in a not in a technical sense, in an artistic sense. How that happened, I don't know, because artistic input came from every part, even my assistant Richard, from me, George Martin, the Beatles, whatever. And it created this thing. And you know, someone said to me, "You're so upset," and you're saying, "Oh, I can't believe I'm here looking at you. My life is based on you." And you know, and I respect that, you know. And it's not just I just ignore it because I know what it actually means to people. It's very, you know, real.
It is very real.
But it won't happen with Justin Bieber. Can you imagine a Justin Bieber fucking conference when Justin Bieber's done changed my life? No way.
No, there's a difference between being a pop star and being a legend. And you are part of a legacy. You are part of a legacy that will live on from generation to generation. And you do have a piece of every single person who feels a connection to that legacy. No, and that's a wonderful thing.
Absolutely. I know that.
And
you know?
It's a wonderful thing. I want to congratulate you for that. And I got to tell you, it's a pleasure to have you here. Thanks for sharing a little bit of your story with us here on Taped with Rabbi Doug.
Can we stop shouting?
Yeah,
we can shout at the camera, right?
Right. Geoff Emerik, here, the engineer of the Beatles, on Taped with Rabbi Doug. Stay with us at the Fest 18. Bye. Well, that's it for part one here at the Fest for Beatles Fans 18 at the Hyatt Regency O'Hare in Chicago. I want to thank Mark Lapidos and all of the guests that we had on this show. We've got a lot more music, a lot more people to talk to, so you won't want to miss the next show, which will be part two at Beatlefest 18. Remember, you can check out our website, www.tvrabbi.com, where you can also see former fests on the web. If you want to email us or anybody here at the fest, info@tvrabbi.com, and I'll forward it on to them if it's for someone else. Don't miss next time right here on Tape with Rabbi Doug at the Fest for Beatles Fans 18 in Chicago. Shalom, everyone. Better.